Yeah, I was fortunate to be brought up in Edinburgh, and in Edinburgh there was really the best and the most grand festival in those years. It began in 1947, 1 year before I was born. I'm actually the oldest here, I think, by a long way, but anyway, I was lucky enough to have Edinburgh as a kind of school. I don't talk about my school, which was very formal and organized and boys only. And I was an only child, so there were a lot of things against me, you know, being connected to the world in a way. But Edinburgh was a fantastic place, and my parents were actually very open to me being connected to theatre, so I saw theatre from a very early age. And in those days, Edinburgh had theatre and music. You know, nowadays it's kind of comedy and pop and stuff like that, but it was fantastic then. So as I was growing up, I realized that I'd probably be connected to some kind of art form in some way. But anyway, I went to university and I did kind of straight social anthropology, and then I went to teaching college. In between that, I was in the brewery for a year drinking beer, trying to find out, you know, what was the path, what was the point. And eventually I realized that teaching was a kind of game of control. And I became immediately an anarchic educationally, and I gave up the school and I went to London, joined a theatre group, and started driving around a really great theatre group called Freehold Theatre, and they were doing very experimental work. Anyway, a few years, I would never have thought I'd be clowning, because in Edinburgh I did a show, a big rock band performance with comedy, which was about John Knox, who was a kind of reformist. What's his name? The German. Anyway, he was a Protestant rebellious kind of Protestant leader in Scotland, Presbyterian. And we called the show Knock Knocks, it's the Reformation Shuffle. And the Scotsman critique said, you know, he downed the music because it was rock and roll, and he said, and John Melville's infantile humor. So this gave me, you know, a framework of that I was worthless in comedy and even, you know, theatrically. So anyway, I suddenly discovered that clown was a phrase which could be used for my infantile humor. And suddenly the word in London, you know, I became a kind of on the very community theater circuit when I just met Django, more or less. This was 1972, I think it was. So I started clowning, and I realized that infantile humor could actually be an art form. And then I realized that, you know, when you make definitions and people want you to live up to a definition, it's actually the worst thing you could do. Because, you know, we are open human beings with many facets and many sides. You know, we dream different things, we relate to people in different ways, with roles. You know, with authority, with children, with whatever. So actually, you know, we're not really at all limited necessarily to a definition. So now I call myself an energy sculptor. And that for me is much more relative for me to understand and help people with than the word clown. Because the word clown has many definitions, and it's got, in England it's got a really bad name, you know, because they think of dress clowns who do nothing except walk around looking beautiful, and or bad circus clowns. And I always actually felt that circus clowns were not really entertaining for me. I used to get very disappointed when I was young and in certain areas of being. But anyway, being an energy sculptor, I discovered that I could actually express myself in different ways. So, you know, when I do performance or teaching or films, I love film and I try to make film all the time, then the word energy sculptor is more for me of an inspiration. And what I want to do really generally is raise frequency of individuals, groups, which will then raise frequency eventually of the planet. And I don't think this, you know, and the human resonance now is raising rapidly, and that's why there's a lot of people with severe problems, because they're not really spiritually necessarily ready for it. And that's why our world is becoming polarized to such an extent that, you know, we have roles of presidents happening which shock us and create certain reactions in us. Now, those things are not necessarily bad, I don't think Trump is necessarily a bad thing to happen. I think it's an inspiring thing to happen because it's going to create energy. And because we're all responsible for whatever happens. We're all responsible for the goods and the bads. We're responsible for the wars. We're responsible for the starvation, the hungry. We are all responsible for changing that and raising that frequency. I try and do it in any way I can. I'm here because, you know, Django told me about it a couple of months ago, and I talked to Boris, and he said, yeah, if you want to come, come. And I said, sure. In the end, it's not necessarily worked out how I thought it was going to be, but, you know, it doesn't matter. Because raising the frequency is what I hope we can all do this week. And then you will take it out and raise it, you know, wherever you can try and raise it, so that it's raising in a kind of, ever-growing way.